Greetings, beloved. God is truly good. And now Family Community Church of Fresno presents Pastor Chester McGensy. Pastor McGensy is an anointed voice to the nations with a clear message, building God's kingdom and empowering God's people. Today's teaching will build you, strengthen you, and unlock some kingdom principles that will give you access to the life God originally designed you to live. You'll be challenged to possess the promises of God for your life. And now, please join Pastor McGensy for this powerful and dynamic message.
The Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 12, you'll find these words starting at verse 28. Mark 12, 28. Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, "Which is the first commandment of all?" Jesus answered him, "The first of all the commandments is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second, like it, is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." So the scribe said to him, "Well said, teacher. You have spoken the truth, for there is one God, and there is no other but he. And the Lord, and love him with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the soul, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is more than all the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." Now when Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You're not far from the kingdom of God." But after that, no one dared ask him question him anymore. Come on, come on. You may be seated. Love God, yes. Love people. Love God, love people. Living a successful Christian life isn't complicated. I'm not saying that it's easy, but it doesn't have to be convoluted with a long list of do's and don'ts. Now, in ancient Israel, the Pharisees had taken the Old Testament law and codified it into 613 regulations. Yes. Somebody said that 248 of them were positive, 365 were negative. A negative for each day of the year, I guess, and then required people to follow these regulations. Even today, there are numerous books that you can read which will tell you how you ought to live your Christian life. Mm-hmm. Many of them are helpful suggestions and guidelines, but living a life that pleases God doesn't have to be complicated. Right. Christ simplified or summarized, if you will, what it is to take two steps, which if we understand these two steps and follow them, the positive consequences will lead of us living a successful, or dare I say, a victorious Christian life. Step one is the choice to love God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Amen. Loving the Supreme Lord, the one true God, the creator of the universe, the creator of you and me, is not optional.
Come on. Come on.
It is the primary duty of every Christian and is foundational to victorious Christian living. But what does it mean to love God? Love, as seen in this command in Greek, is the verb, amen, agapo. Agapo is a love of intelligence, of purpose, of sacrifice, of hard decision. It is a devotional love. In contrast to filio, an emotional, sentimental, or affectional love. However, agapo is a willful love, a determined love that is generously chooses for the interests of others. One writer put it this way: to agapo, to love something, has nothing to do with the warm, fuzzy, or intense feelings. Agapo is about what you are committed to. It's about what comes first in your life. It's about a choice that is made. It isn't splitting literary hairs. It makes an enormous difference how we understand our calling to love God. The Bible makes it explicitly clear that we can agapo things other than God. And in so doing, we're working against the desires that he has for our lives. To agapo in this context is clearly a choice. You have to choose something here. You see, John 3:19 says, the light has come into the world, and men has agapo, or chosen darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil.
Yes.
John 12:43, they loved, or they agapo, or they chose the praise of men more than the praise of God. Luke 11:43, woe to you Pharisees, because you love or agapo, or you have chosen the best seats in the synagogue, amen, and in the marketplaces. Matthew 6:24, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and agapo, or choose the other, amen, or he will devote oneself and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. And then 1 John 2:15, do not love, agapo, or choose the world or things in the world. You see, our love for God must be a choice of an across-the-board commitment to put God and his will above everything else. There must be absolutely no holding back or incompleteness in our devotion and our commitment to God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. It must be sincere from the heart, intelligent with the mind, emotional with the soul, intense and energetic with our strength. We are to agapo, to love, to choose, to obey God with everything that we have. Anything but a love for God that encompasses all of one's being and every area of one's life falls short of God's will for your life. The goal of agapo love is that through a commitment to know, to honor, to respect, and willfully follow Christ in everything, we will be led to a filial love of intimate and personal love for God and for the Lord Jesus Christ. That will be manifested in our transformed lives, that radiate the joy of Christ. You mean, if I love God the way I'm supposed to, if I choose to love God and honor him and to know him and to respect him and willfully follow him, amen, my life will be transformed and it will radiate with the joy of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm saying that you ought to walk into a room and light it up. Light it up, because you love God and you've made that choice. And the radiating joy of Christ is in your life. I know there's a lot of sad stuff happening in the world right now. I know there's a lot of heartache and a lot of pain, but if I know God and I honor him and I respect him and I willfully follow him, I ought to radiate with the joy of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Loving God with the strength of my mind and the strength of my emotions and the strength of my will makes Christians have strong character and truly allows them to live a balanced life.
Hmm.
The choice, step one. Step two is the charge to love people.
Amen.
Loving God, I think I can get that. The charge to love people. And the second like it is this, you shall love your neighbor. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now I'm just being real here. That's a heavy lift. I feel like Moses up here right now. Loving others is not optional. For the child of God, it's a command. It's a present imperative. It's something we're commanded. We're given a charge to do it.
Amen.
If I really love God, and I'm going to really love people, I've been given a charge to do just that.
Amen.
Absolute obedience to the second great commandment is impossible without fully obeying the first. Are you about to help me here?
Amen.
In other words, you can't really love people the way you ought to love people until you love God right first.
Amen.
In leadership training, I share with brothers that I say, you're not going to love your wife any more than you love God. You're not going to treat your wife any better than you treat God. So if you want to treat your wife better, you start out by treating God better.
Amen.
Lady, if you got a husband ain't doing you right, don't give him grief about what he's not doing for you. Give him grief about what he's not doing for God. Because if he get right with God, he'll get right with you. Amen. Loving others means loving every believer, not just those that you have an affinity or some common interest with. Because I see in 1 John 3:14, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren.
Yeah. Yeah.
He who does not love his brethren abideth in death. If I'm not really loving people the way God has loved me and the way I should be loving God, listen, he says, I'm not living at all. I'm just a walking dead. 1 John 4:1-7 and verse 20 says, beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God, that's born again, and knows God.
Amen.
He who does not love does not know God, for God is
love.
And this, the love of God, was manifested towards us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is love, that we love God, but that God loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another.
Amen.
Then in verse 20 it says, for if God says, I love God, for if someone says, I love God and hates his brother, mm-hmm. he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? Loving others is a willful and purposeful choice and commitment which does not seek its own interest, but always unselfishly seeks the best interests of the other person. Now, love for others is not based on how they treat or act towards you. Now, see, that's where you mess me up right now. I gotta say that one again. Love for others is not based on how they treat or they act towards you.
Amen.
Oh,
no. Wait, you got to help me out here a little bit. Matthew 5:43 says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbors. Yeah, I heard that. And hate your enemies. Well, I'm all right with that. Oh, come on now. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you.
That's right.
Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. Hold up just a moment. I'm supposed to love those that don't have my best interest at heart. Yes. I'm supposed to love those that walk me down, talk me down, amen, don't care nothing about me. Yes, I'm supposed to. But I say to you, love your enemies. Love covers a multitude of faults.
Amen.
Regardless to how they treat you, regardless how they act around you.
Amen.
That love is a heavy lift, isn't it? In order to love others, you must see the value in other people. Our ability to love depends on recognizing God and how God values them. For instance, if someone hurts you, do you get angry and filled with resentment and you want them to know that you're not happy with them at all? No. You both used to come to 9 o'clock. Now you come to 11 and they come to 9 just to make sure you don't have to cross paths. Resentment built up in the heart. You hurt me. You hurt me. Nobody hurts me. And get away with it. Does this resentment cause you to devalue them? Now they're less than what God says that they are because they hurt you. So you can get even with them. You have to devalue them so you can let them know just how mad you are. Or does this resentment cause you to pull away out of fear from getting hurt anymore? All right, you're going to do me like that? I'm through with you. I'm through with you. If so, you have devalued them based on their treatment of you. Because you value yourself greater than you value them. You're not loving them as you love yourself. Because you forgive yourself. Have you ever done anything to hurt yourself? Absolutely, you have. Have you ever made some bad choices that affected your life? Yes, you have. Have you forgiven yourself? Yes, you have. Love your neighbor. Christ died on the cross for them and their sins, just as much as he died on the cross for you and for your sin. The same cross. Listen, we all are in here because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And the ground at the bottom of the cross is level. There's no high sins and low sins and middle grade sins. No, sin is just sin and stench in the nostrils of a holy and righteous God. It's the cross that makes everything level.
Amen.
The charge to love others is ever forgiving, ever seeking out for reconciliation. How do we get past this? How do we work through this? Love is always looking for a better way.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 13:5b says, amen, in the NIV, it says, love does not keep a record of wrong. I mean, it doesn't have a list.
Come on.
Amen. And used to be, I say, I've got a big legal pad, but now we got a tablet, a computer full of a list of folk who have hurt me, folk who have wounded me. I got a backpack on my back with a list of names of people that have wounded my soul. But the Bible says love does not keep a record of wrong. That's telling me I got to burn up my book.
Amen.
I got to burn up my book.
Yes, sir. Come on.
I'm not talking to you. It's the person next sitting next to you. Burn up the book. Matthew 5:24. Therefore, if any of you bring a gift to the altar and remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother. And then come and offer your gift. God says we need to get our hearts and our lives right with one another.
Mm-hmm.
Matthew 18:15, moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone.
Amen.
If he hears you, you've gained your brother.
Yeah.
Amen. This scripture is a scripture we use for church discipline. And the whole spirit of church discipline is not about punishing somebody or running somebody off. It's always about trying to reconcile. How do we get through what we've done? Amen. How do we get right with God and my fellow brother again? Amen. If your brother has sinned against you, if you have resentment against somebody, amen, the Bible says go to him between you and him alone and try to work it out. Try to work it out. If they hear you, you've gained your brother. If not, at least you've got peace with yourself and with God that you've done everything else right.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, don't allow somebody to use your head for a garbage can. Hey, brother, you know what? This brother right there, I don't know about him. And let me just dump all this stuff in your head about this brother. The thing I need to do is to get you to go talk to that brother. And if you don't want to go by yourself, I need to get you by the hand and we can call a meeting with this brother and work it out. That's how you regain your brother and the relationship back. That's called love. That's called love. But many of us, we'd rather not love. We'd rather keep our backpack filled with your name on my list. We're not supposed to hold grudges as children of Almighty God. Do you want to leave this planet with a backpack full of grudges and stand before your Lord and God and say, amen, listen, God, I'm so glad I made it here, but I got some little backpack I had to bring up to heaven with me. I sure hope I don't run into these people up in here. Loving others is caring for the needs and the burdens of others.
Yes, sir.
1 John 3:17, if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes up his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Whatever God has blessed you with can be a blessing to somebody else.
Amen.
This is where sometimes we get a little grief about, why are we starting all these churches in Kenya? Why we got this orphanage over here we're trying to support in Haiti? Because God has given us a little something that we can give and help somebody else with. What difference does it make to you? If you don't want to participate, don't participate. But allow the church to be the church where God has called us to be. And if God says it's in Kenya, it's in Kenya. If God wants us to be in Russia, it'd be in Lips, Russia. If he wants to be in Cartagena, South America, that's where it'd be. If he wants it to be in Auckland, New Zealand, that's where it'd be.
Right.
Wherever God has sent us and God called us to move, we move with what little we have. Because little becomes much when it's put in the master's hand. Love other people. Whatever God has blessed you with, you ought to be a blessing to somebody else.
Yes.
The arrogance of some. Galatians 6:2, bear ye one another's burdens,
yes,
and so fulfill the law of Christ. Allow me to take a step back, because it just really something just dropped in my spirit. It reminded me when we went to Haiti. Some of you have heard the story that we went to that orphanage and we went to pray. We didn't have a lot of gifts to give to people at that time, but we prayed and we came back and shared the burden with the church.
Mm-hmm.
And the church heard it, that it was 52 kids and a couple of adults, and there was 2 chickens that they were cooking for those 52, and that was the meal for the week. And listen, those chickens could use some food stamps themselves. I'm telling you, they were thin. They weren't foster farmed. Amen. And because of your heart and
amen.
Your generosity, we began to bless that church and amen, help it be able to get some chicken coops built. And now that orphanage has more chickens and more eggs. So now they're giving chickens and eggs to the orphanage. They all started because somebody loved it. What little bit they had can make a difference. When the church is the church, God is glorified. Now, God could have picked somebody out of Florida, which is a lot closer to Port-au-Prince, Haiti, than we are, but God reached down into the valley of Fresno and found a church that go over here and do this in my name and for my glory. Amen to God. Amen. To the glory. Hold me together, Holy Spirit. Galatians 6:2. Bear one another's burdens to fulfill the law of Christ. Loving others is also seen in the value of a soul caring enough to share Christ with those who do not know Christ and have not received his grace. The Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 9, talk about the great heaviness and the continual sorrow. Listen, that he had in his heart that he carried as a burden for the lost souls of Israel. If you love God and if you love people, you will love lost souls.
Amen.
You will love lost souls. Not just souls, but lost souls.
Praise
Psalms 126 and 5, those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing precious seed, seed sowing, shall doubtless come again rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves with him. What are you saying? I'm saying that there's great strength, there's great power in continuing to share the love of Jesus Christ, of continuing to love lost souls and sharing the message of Jesus Christ in your neighborhoods, down two cubicles down, across the fence, sharing it. Yeah. Makes no difference. Don't worry about it. It may get hard sometimes. You may get talked about sometimes. Who do you think you are? Listen, you just keep on planting the seeds.
Right.
And the Bible says you'll come in rejoicing. You'll walk the aisle with friends that you talk to. Amen. But giving their hearts to Jesus Christ. You come in bringing in the sheaves of souls being won for the kingdom of God. All give God some praise in the house of God today. Angels in heaven rejoice.
Some of you may have read about this notorious criminal, career criminal. He committed numerous burglaries and then ultimately he was convicted and sentenced to hang for murdering a man. On the morning of his execution, a clergyman led him out of the cell and began to walk towards his end. And as he began to walk, he was reading scripture. The man that was going to be hung tapped the clergyman on the shoulder and asked him a question. He says, "Do you believe what you're reading?" Wait a minute. "Do you believe what you're reading?" And he said, "Oh, yes, yes, I believe it." He said to the preacher, "Sir, I do not share your faith. But if I did, if I believe what you say you believe, then if this country were covered with broken glass from coast to coast, I would crawl the length and the breadth of it on hands and knees and think the pain worthwhile just to save a single soul from this eternal hell from which you speak. I wonder when was the last time we got out of our comfort zone to share the love of Jesus Christ with a dying soul. A lost and dying soul. Not the last time you shared, amen, the church service with somebody that, amen, that's already saved. When was the last time you knew a soul that was headed to hell and you opened up your mouth and your Bible and you shared in your heart and shared the love of Jesus Christ with them? When was the last time? Is it worthy? Is it worthy of the potential rejection? Is it worthy that you may be laughed at and scorned? Is it worthy enough? Is that soul worthy? Now, your greatest need, and as a Christian, and for every Christian, is a concern for lost and dying souls. You have no claim to Christ's likeness unless you're concerned about the souls of other people. Without concerns, we're not obeying the scriptures. We're not honoring are charged to love God and love people. My Bible tells me that the fruit of the righteous is the tree of life. And he who wins souls is wise. And then finally, the consequences of love. I hear the Apostle Paul saying, "For he," meaning Jesus, "is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us." For he, Jesus, is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Jesus fixed it so everyone can come to him.
Yes.
I said, Jesus fixed it so that everyone can come to him. Not who the pastor or the board of deacons think is worth. No matter how dirty your soul may be this morning, how ugly you've been over the last year, You may have a mean spirited soul. Your soul may be broken this morning. You may be giving up on life and your soul feels hopeless. You too can come to Christ the way you are today. Dirty, ugly, mean, broken, and hopeless. Come the way you are to Christ today. You don't have to go home and get something right and come back. You can come to Christ today. He will accept you and will transform your life for his good. If the church and church people would love God and love people, they would stop putting up barriers and building walls to keep people out of the church. Jesus is saying to us, the family, no more walls. No more walls. No more walls. Now, usually in the Old Testament, when the Bible mentions walls, it's speaking of strength and protection. Mm-hmm. A city without walls was considered weak and vulnerable. Yes. But the drawback to having these great walls to protect and to keep the enemy out was that they also trapped the citizens within. Mm-hmm. We have much the same thing happening today, but it's more on a spiritual level. Too many of God's people have erected walls to protect themselves from the enemy.
Come on.
But these walls are not natural. They are spiritual. They are not built with hammers and nails, brick and mortar. But these walls have been built out of ideas and traditions and prejudices and fear of men. Now, the middle wall, not the veil, the middle wall that Jesus destroyed was the wall between the Jews and the Gentiles. From those that believed they were righteous, holy, and saved, and those that knew they were on the outside. Jesus tore down the wall between those on the inside and those on the outside. Walls not only keep our enemies out, but they also imprison us. And worst of all, they keep us from reaching the very souls we're called to send to and to love. Walls separate, divide, limit, isolate, and insulate. Walls limit vision. The wall of vision, we've never seen it done like this before. Walls. That's not the way we do it here, walls. If I can't see it, it must not be, I can't believe it, walls. Walls limit vision, but walls limit expression. Walls of traditional service and thinking limits creativity. Some of us, we can't stand up and clap our hands and praise unless it's an old song back the way I was when I traditionally grew up, amen, the way mama used to sing. If it's a newer song that reaches the congregation and the people of today, I don't want to react. I'll just sit right there. You go ahead and do what you gotta do. I don't feel nothing with that. Wrong. If you're gonna do something in service other than just preach and just do this or just do this, I'm conveniently absent. Why? Because I'm putting up a wall that I don't want to have anything to do with that. Jesus said, too many walls in the church. Walls limit growth. Just like a fish will grow in size in proportion to the limitations of its environment, so will individuals who are in incorporation bodies. They will grow to the limits of the potential of their limitation of their thinking, of their ability to hear God, respond to God when God speaks. Amen. Too many walls in the church. Walls isolate. Walls keep people out. When we want to be, amen, alone, we put up walls all around us. Some of you right now, you don't want to be bothered, amen. You got a wall all around you right now. Sitting around 300 or 400 people, you all by yourself, isolated, by yourself. Amen. The part of the service I hate the most is when he say, shake somebody's hand or give somebody a hug. No. Let down the wall and give somebody a hug. And if you don't want to look around, put a window in the wall and stick your hand to it and shake it to the back. Wall, isolate myself off. In the church, around 300 or 400 folks, and you're the loneliest person in the room. Wall. We isolate ourselves. These walls may be invisible, but they're real enough to separate us from everyone that wants to get in and to love us. The problem is these walls, they isolate us from the ones we're supposed to be getting close to. Close enough to be salt in their lives.
and then walls insulate. Insulation is to hold in. We buy various thermals because they insulate. They hold the heat in your coffee. They hold the cold in your iced tea or your Diet Pepsi. Whatever the flavor. You ain't heard nothing wrong with this. But the church was never intended to live in isolation, in an isolated environment. So we're never meant to be a private club, simply holding on and protecting the membership of the elite. Oh, brother pastor, better do what they want to do. They're going to leave. No. We're not, it's not a membership of the elite. We are church, the body of Christ. There's no elite members in the house of God. Every last one of us are sinners saved by the grace of Almighty God. My sin stunk in God's nostrils, just like your sin stinks in God's nostrils. There's no elite in the house of God. The church is to be the gate of heaven. We are the church building the kingdom of God. Amen. Through the church, men and women, boys and girls, gain entrance to Jesus Christ. We must not allow anything to hold back the entrance to the kingdom of heaven. Luke 11:52, woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter in yourselves. You hinder those who are trying to get in. Matthew 23:13, but woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourself, neither suffer them to enter in and go in. I hear the Bible talking to me now. In Revelation 22:17, it says the Spirit and the Bride says come. Don't listen to these folk that tell you you can't come. They're trying to block the door to keep you from getting in. They won't go in themselves, but they don't want you to get in. But the Spirit of God of the Bride says, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who is thirsty, come. Whoever desires, let him take of the water of life freely. All, in John 6:37, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will in no wise cast him out. I did say that some come dirty, some come hungry, some come thirsty, some come ugly, some come broken down, some come all kind of ways. I'm here to declare, if you just come to Jesus the way that you are, it may be somebody at the door, somebody you sit next to, they got a wall, but if you just can get around that wall long enough and come into the house of God, Jesus says he will in no way cast you out. You come just the way that you are today. Anything that restricts the whosoever will from getting to Jesus through the church is a wall. And listen, it must be torn down. We dare not put up bars and restrictions where Jesus has placed an open door. Jesus has opened up the doors of the church. I know a lot of traditional churches, at the end we call it, oh, we'll open up the doors of the church. No, Jesus opened up the door of the church. Amen. And it's been open ever since he opened the door. Amen. And it won't close until he closes it. It's an open door. It's for whosoever will. Yeah. We build walls to protect ourselves, but when those walls keep other people from reaching out, amen, keep up from reaching out to the drug addict, to the prostitute, to the homosexual, to the rich, to the poor, to the Asian, to the black, to the Hispanic, to the white, listen, then those walls that we so-called protecting us are killing us. The Dead Sea is the Dead Sea for one reason, because there's no outlet. There's water coming in, but nothing is going out. And it becomes stagnant, and it becomes polluted, and nothing can live in it. I don't want to be a part of a stagnant, dead church where people just come in and join the church, but nobody's going back out trying to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. Amen. We have to reach out to people everywhere around the globe. I hear Revelation 5:9 says, and they sung a new song. Not that old traditional song, but a new song. It's a new song, not some song with some geriatric type of thing where we're going, da, 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 and F flat if there's such a key. I love you, No. Put some pep in it. Put some strength in it. Put your soul in it. Put your mind in it. Put your backbone in it. Amen. They sang a new song to the
the Lord. He says, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open up a seal, for you were slain. Yet you have redeemed us to God by your blood. And out of every tribe, hey, not only Americans, not only Africans, not only South Americans, but out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, God is calling people into the kingdom of Almighty God. Amen. And have made us kings and priests to our God. And we shall reign on the earth. Amen. Redeeming the work of Christ. Amen. From every tongue and every nation.
Yes,
we must not be guilty of allowing walls in the church to hinder and the redeeming grace of Almighty God. What are you saying? I'm saying that this Bible is not a rich man's Bible. It's not a white man's Bible. It's not a red man or yellow man or a black man's Bible. It's not an educated man's Bible. It's for whosoever will. Whosoever will. Let him come. Let him come. Let him come. Right now to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If we do not become a church without walls, we will die and our walls will kill us.
Amen.
We will cease to exist as a lighthouse. As a lighthouse to people who are navigating the shores, the storm of life.
Yeah.
Amen. We cease to be a lighthouse. And as an instrument of Christ, to be a saving and healing and spiritual influence in our communities.
Yeah.
We want our church to be recognized as a church without walls. This community needs to know that there's an open door to heaven on the corner of Chestnut and Knees in Fresno, California. Our model ought to be the same as Jesus Christ. Whosoever will, let him come and take of the water of life freely. No more walls. Let me close this thing out. If we do not become a church without walls, we'll become a pillar of salt. A pillar of salt is what happens when salt is shut up to itself. You ever leave salt in a salt shaker too long and just leave it there and don't shake anything out? What happens when the church loses its salt? And, amen, it loses God's vision, God's purpose, and God's passion. Salt really is useless unless it leaves the shaker.
So
I believe this is what the prophet Isaiah was saying and talking about in Isaiah 16:18. He says, violence shall be no longer be heard in your land. Why? When you really love God and you love people, listen, violence shall no longer be heard in your land, neither wasting nor destruction within your borders. But you shall be called, listen, but you shall call your walls salvation and your gates praise. The walls that God desires for the church today are walls of salvation and the gates of praise. People ought to know without a doubt when they come in this place, the only walls that are standing are walls of salvation. The only door you come through is a gate of praise. You ought to come in here singing the songs of Zion. On your way to church in the morning, you ought to be singing the songs of Zion. And you ought to have your stereo up. These kids today, they got boom, 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 boom. Well, don't let me say today, because I was one of them kids yesterday. Amen. Boom, 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 and had that stuff loud and a speaker on the outside. We ought to be singing the praises of Almighty God. Like that. People ought to see us singing in our car, rocking out in our family, giving praise to God. Amen. Zechariah 2:4 says, who said to him, run, run, run. Speak to this young man saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as a town without walls because of the multitude of men and livestock. In other words, listen, Jerusalem won't be able to have walls to contain the blessings of Almighty God. God is going to bless us because we love him so much. We love other people so much that we don't need man-made walls anymore. How are we going to protect all this stuff? Amen. It goes on to say in verse 5, for I, saith the Lord, will be a wall of fire around her, and I will be the glory in her midst. You will not need walls because God is going to be your protection. Not only defend you from the attacks, but amen, but consume the enemy who will pursue after you and to assault you. You don't have to worry about the enemy coming after you. He may be clipping on your heels like a barracuda. He's about to clip you down, and you're thinking, but listen, you just leave it with God and leave it right there. Listen, what? It's a wall of fire. Let me just stop long enough to say this about this wall of fire. Because this wall of fire is what was in the fiery furnace. A lot of times we talk about Meshach, and the Abednego that was in the fiery furnace, and the king looked off in there, and said, boy, there's like four in there. And they're walking around in the fiery furnace. But what the king didn't know is that he made his fire seven times hotter than it normally is, but there was a fire greater than his seven times fire that was surrounding the people of God. And when God shows up in the fire of protection in your life, no matter what you're facing, it's greater than what the enemy can bring your way. And God protects his own. God provides for his own. When you stand up and love God and love people, listen, and you bring down the walls, God will put a wall of fire around you, the wall of salvation. Amen. He said, and the glory will be manifested. His glory will be manifested in your life by the mighty deeds he will do. God will begin to do things in your life that when other folk look at, they know that's nobody but God. They know your background. They know where you come from. They know what you've done. They know the 411 and 911 and everything about you. Amen. But they, when they look at your life now, they see there's nothing but God. Look at where you come from. Some of us need to take a ride back to the neighborhood we grew up in. Sometimes we got so far away from our neighborhood, got a nice little job, nice little retirement, got a little this, got a little that, nice little car, and we think we're all this in a bag of chips and show up with our own dip. You need to go back to where you come from and see how far God has brought you and what God has done for you. Amen. And remember that it was the love of God that reached out and you were dead in your sin, and he stepped in and made a way. His providential care has brought you to where you are today. Amen. 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 People will know your dwelling place, that you dwell with God. That's the pillar of fire and the Shekinah glory that's in your life. When you see the Shekinah glory of God, amen, you run there. You run there. When there's a church with an open door, when the invitation gives, you run there. Amen. Proverbs 18 says it, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they're safe. Amen. Amen. You run into where God is and you'll be saved. Oh, let me close this thing out. I hear Isaiah whispering the last word, Isaiah 61 and 2. He says, arise and shine. Arise and shine, for your light has come. And the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. But Pastor, you're saying the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. No. But Pastor, there's darkness in my life. Well, he says that. Behold, the whole earth is dark. And amen, and deep darkness covers the people. Wow. But he says, arise and shine. Why? Because the Lord has risen over you. It's in the midst of the darkness that the glorious light of Jesus Christ shines in your heart and shines in your life. When you love God and you love people and there's no more walls, the glory of God will begin to shine down in this house of God like it's never shined down before. Amen. God is calling us to love God and to love people and to get rid of the walls, get rid of unforgiveness, get back to our knees before a holy and righteous God and begin to praise him and worship him in spirit and in truth with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, with all of our being. Give everything, let everything to have breath. Praise be the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, bless his holy name.
Thank you for joining Pastor Chester McGensy for this powerful teaching. Family Community Church of Fresno is empowering millions of people around the world through dynamic preaching and teaching, humanitarian aid, and many other ministry efforts. For additional information and resources from Family Community Church, please visit www.familycommunitychurch.com or call 559-323-5002. We look forward to serving you in the kingdom.